Well, it's early in the morning, where I ride, Lordy mama.
We begin our discussion of mass incarceration with this simple statistic. When I first came across these numbers, I honestly couldn't believe them. Could it really be possible that our country incarcerates more people per capita than any other country in the world? Yes, indeed it could. This is the latest 2020 country data from the Sentencing Project, an organization that works to address unjust racial disparities and practices in our criminal justice system. Let's turn now and look at the data for our own state of Massachusetts. Our per capita incarceration rate in 2018 was less than half that of the country as a whole. As a matter of fact, our rate was actually the lowest for any state in the country. That's good. However, our rate was still larger than that of virtually all European countries. The state with the highest incarceration rate is Oklahoma. That state has just about 1,000 people incarcerated per 100,000 residents. Think about that for a moment. 1,000 per 100,000 means that at any given time, 1% of the entire population of Oklahoma is in prison, serving sentences for serious crimes, or in jail, awaiting trial, or serving shorter sentences for less serious offenses. Digging deeper, we note that Oklahoma has a population of just under 4 million people. This means that Oklahoma has approximately 40,000 of its residents incarcerated at any given time. This graphic shows Oklahoma's prison incarceration rates by race and ethnicity in 2017. Whites are 70% of the state population, and they make up 52% of the prison population. Blacks are only 8% of the state population, yet they account for 25% of the prison population. Here is Bryan Stevenson of the Equal Justice Initiative speaking in 2018 about the consequences of such high incarceration rates.
I come from a country that now has the highest rate of incarceration in the world. We have 5% of the world's population, 25% of the world's incarcerated. We're putting women and children and people in jails and prisons indiscriminately. Today in the United States, 1 in 3 black male babies born is expected to go to jail or prison. There is despair. In the communities where I work, I go into communities where I talk to 13-year-old children who tell me they don't believe they're going to be free by the time they're 21.
In a 2003 report on the prevalence of imprisonment in the United States, statistician Thomas Bonzar of the U.S. Department of Justice reported numbers that others have turned into the dramatic graphic you see here. Note the glaring discrepancies between the incarceration rates for blacks and whites, both for men and for women. So how did it happen that so many American citizens have become incarcerated? The issue is, of course, complex, but we can at least begin to understand it by looking at some of the key factors. First, in the 1960s, we saw the deinstitutionalization of the mentally ill. This means that people with psychiatric problems who ran afoul of the law fell into the clutches of our criminal justice system rather than our healthcare system. Then, in 1971, President Richard Nixon declared a, quote, war on drugs, close quote. Once again, a problem that could have been seen as a social or health problem came under the auspices of the criminal justice system. In 1981, Ronald Reagan was elected president and picked up the mantle. Reagan's policies swelled prison populations dramatically, as illustrated in the next video.
In 1986, when I was coming of age, Ronald Reagan doubled down on the war on drugs that had been started by Richard Nixon in 1971. Drugs were bad, fried your brain. And drug dealers were monsters, the sole reason neighborhoods and major cities were failing. No one wanted to talk about Reaganomics and the ending of social safety nets, the defunding of schools and the loss of jobs in cities across America. Judges' hands were tied by tough-on-crime laws, and they were forced to hand out mandatory life sentences for simple possession and low-level drug sales. My home state of New York started this with Rockefeller laws. Then the feds made distinctions between people who sold powder cocaine and crack cocaine, even though they were the same drug. Only difference is how you take it. And even though white people used and sold crack more than black people, somehow it was black people who went to prison. The media ignored actual data to this day. Crack is still talked about as a black problem.
The steepest part of the prison population growth curve we've been looking at begins in 1984. This is when the private prison industry came into being. The companies that run these prisons have revenues of $3.3 billion, of which they spend about $25 million on lobbying politicians to be tougher on crime. The relationship between these companies and the fact that they are compensated per inmate is one of the contributing factors to mass incarceration. In the next video, Bryan Stevenson is speaking on mass imprisonment at Harvard University's Kennedy School of Government in 2015. In this clip, he is answering a student question on factors other than the war on drugs and racism that have contributed to the huge growth in the prison population that we've been talking about.
I do think economics has increasingly become a contributor to mass incarceration. And that's not about race and about the narrative per se. We now have private industries that have an economic model pushing them to maintain a high level of incarceration. So if I say, let's not put any more people in prison for simple possession of marijuana, and people say, yeah, that's a great idea, these private companies are going to send lobbyists to the legislature to make sure that bill doesn't get passed. Why? Not because they think that's a bad idea, but because they need to keep 2.3 million people in jails and prisons. They have an economic incentive to maintain high rates of incarceration. And we've never had to deal with a moneyed lobbying group that's about sustaining mass incarceration.
Another factor, and one that contributes to this day, is the disproportionate assumption of guilt perpetrated upon people of color. Here is Bryan Stevenson again, emphatically making this point in his address to graduates of the University of Pennsylvania in 2019.
For decades, my parents were humiliated every day of their lives. They'd see those signs that said white and colored. They weren't directions, they were assaults, and they created wounds, and we haven't treated these wounds. And today, that narrative is still with us, and that's why I look at you. I was watching you as you came in. You're so beautiful, and you're so gifted. And it's why it breaks my heart to have to say to some of you that despite the fact that you're outstanding graduates of this university, despite the fact that you've mastered law and medicine and engineering and business and the arts and science, it breaks my heart to have to say to some of you that despite all of that and all of these achievements, if you're black or brown, you will go places in this country where you're going to have to navigate a presumption of dangerousness and guilt just because of your color. It shouldn't be like that.
The Equal Justice Initiative also notes that mass incarceration affects the poor much more than the wealthy, even before trial, because the poor cannot afford the bail that judges set for their release. The effects of mass incarceration also extend far beyond the person incarcerated. They are particularly devastating to children. An article published by the American Academy of Political and Social Science specifically notes that the high male incarceration rates, quote, leave women to contend with raising children on their own while their partners cycle in and out of jail. And when mothers of small children are sent to prison, the effect on the child can be even more devastating. One study found that when a mother is incarcerated, the chance of her child being able to stay in the family home is only 1 in 20. That means 95% of children of incarcerated women are forced to go live somewhere other than in the home to which they are accustomed while their mothers are in prison. The cost of mass incarceration is staggering, especially when viewed against the amount spent on education. On average, states spend 2.5 times as much on incarceration as they do on education. It has been estimated that if instead of incarcerating prisoners, the state of California instead sent them all to one of the University of California campuses, the state would save about $7 billion per year. For both whites and blacks, education level plays a key role in one's chances of being incarcerated. The data shown here clearly illustrate that high school dropouts have a far greater chance of serving in time in prison than those who at least finished high school. And what happens when people get out of prison? Their prison records immediately lock them out of certain types of employment and housing. With convictions for serious crimes, such as those involving firearms, they may lose state and federal benefits, such as education assistance or even their driver's licenses. Is it any wonder, then, that state recidivism rates, that is, the percentage of former prisoners who end up back in prison within 3 years, range from 23% at best in the states colored blue and green on this map, to 64% at worst in the states colored orange and brown? Numerous studies have shown that gainful employment that instills hope for the future is one of the most important factors in deterring crime and repeat offenses. All the statistics we've looked at show that mass incarceration affects blacks and other people of color far more than it does whites. As we've seen throughout this series, one of the underlying reasons for this is the unequal treatment that blacks and other minorities have been subject to throughout the entire history of our country. Hopefully, however, recent events, such as the protests against police brutality, are the beginning of a turning point. First, in addition to organizations such as the Equal Justice Initiative and the NAACP that we've already mentioned, there are numerous other organizations working to end mass incarceration. Second, I have been encouraged by the number of protests and vigils sparked by George Floyd's murder, including the vigil on our own Chelmsford Common on June 5th of this year. I was especially pleased to see the number of white people who took part in that vigil. As hard as we might try, those of us who are white cannot fully appreciate the discrimination and racism that blacks and other minorities experience every day of their lives. But as this sign says, which I photographed in Mason, New Hampshire, we can certainly stand up and confront the many inequities they face and work to eliminate them. Ibram X. Kendi has said that not being racist just isn't good enough in our current society. Today, one must actively be anti-racist. Kendi argues that, quote, "the only remedy to racist discrimination is anti-racist discrimination," unquote. Kendi also echoes Supreme Court Justice Harry Blackmun, who wrote in 1978, quote, "to get beyond racism, we must first take account of race. To treat some persons equally, we must treat them differently." I put considerable hope in the signs, both physical, as the last few slides have shown, and intangible, as we see on the news almost every evening these days, that we are turning a corner. I feel that it is appropriate to end the lecture part of this series with a lesson from John Robert Lewis, who was called, quote, "the conscience of Congress," and who passed away this year on July 17th. The clip we're about to show is from Lewis's address at UMass Lowell's 2007 commencement ceremony.
As graduates at the University of Mass at Lowell, the wind may blow, the thunder may roll, the lightning may flash, and the rain may beat on our old house. Call it the House of Boston. Call it the House of the University of Mass at Lowell. Call it the American House. Call it the World House. We all live in the same house. Maybe our foremothers and our forefathers all came to this great land in different ships, but we're all in the same boat now. It doesn't matter whether we're black or white or Hispanic or Asian American or Native American. We're one people. We're one family. We're one house. Stay with the house. Don't leave the house. Hold the house down. Find a way to get in the way. Keep the faith and keep your eyes on the prize. Good luck to you.
May we work together to fill Martin Luther King Jr.'s dream and make our country truly the United States of America, with liberty and justice for all. To complete this series, I've invited my UMass Lowell colleague, Dr. Robert Ferrant, a distinguished university professor of history, to give us his perspective on the civil rights unrest that we're seeing today. Hi, Bob.
Morning. Pleasure to be here.
I'd like to start by asking about the many protests that we're seeing today. We've seen professional athletes refuse to play to bring attention to Jacob Blake's shooting in Wisconsin. And right here in Chelmsford, on the Chelmsford Common, there was a big rally after George Floyd's murder. Have any of these types of protests ever resulted in significant changes for civil rights?
I think the short answer is no single thing has made the significant change. If by significant we think of something like the Voting Rights Bill and the Civil Rights Act in the mid-1960s, that was an accumulation of things that occurred over a long period of time. So in the moment that we're in now, there is an accumulation of events, some of them really horrible, including the shooting of Jacob Blake, but all sorts of other events that have happened all summer long, back 2, 3, 4 years in time, and the accumulation of those sorts of events precipitates protest, reaction, people begin to make demands on the political system, and that's what usually makes change over time. So it's not, the difficulty is, I think, the way normally civil rights history is taught in public schools and in the university as well, is we look at these big events and we think that's the civil rights movement and that's civil rights history. So we look at the March on Washington, which the anniversary of was just in late August from 1963, and we think that made then the changes that came in 64 and 65 with the Civil Rights and Voting Rights Act. But the 1963 March on Washington for Jobs and Freedom, where Martin Luther King made the speech that we all know, the I Have a Dream speech, that would never have happened with hundreds of thousands of people in Washington, D.C., without the accumulation of events back from even before World War II. So historians usually think that change gets made incrementally, and then you do have like a dramatic event. Think of, we're just celebrating the anniversary of women's suffrage, the 19th Amendment, and you could think the 19th Amendment just happened, and so wow, look at that, it all happened in 1920. No, women were struggling to get the vote from before the American Civil War, and it culminates with something. And so if we don't teach it that way, sort of see this out over time, we miss the bigger picture, which I think, again, as a historian, is really important for people to see. And I know that's what, in the program, in the episodes that you've put together, that's what you've done. You've sort of walked people through what historians would call the long view. And I think that's fundamental to understanding American history.
One difference I've seen between the protests today and those I've seen in the past is that there seem to be a lot of more white people involved. How do white people look at the history that we've been discussing? Do they think that it's something that they should feel guilty about? Or perhaps it's a call to action? Or maybe they think it just has nothing to do with them because it happened so long ago?
I think it's actually all three, depending on the person, even maybe depending on the day of the week you catch them and ask them. Because for a lot of people think of what happened in the past and the enslavement of millions of people as something they had nothing to do with. And so when people bring up now you know, the institution of slavery, in that at the inception, if you will, of the country, in a way, slavery is embedded in the apple pie of America, so to speak. Well, that doesn't have anything to do with me, so I don't want to hear that. You know, that's got nothing at all personal or with any relationship to me at all. Other people will hang their head and feel guilty. I mean, I would prefer people see it as a challenge to try to say, okay, all people should have equal rights, equal access to employment, equal access to the right to vote, all the other things that as a white guy in America, an older white guy in America, I take for granted. Everybody should have those same things, and so some people will then feel, who are showing up for marches and protests, that they do have a responsibility, and that they have to use, privilege is a word that gets thrown around a lot these days, right? Well, I feel like as a university professor, I sure have that, particularly in COVID times. I'm being paid and I'm doing my job, but a lot of other people aren't. And so I do feel it's incumbent on me to do something, to say something, to come to a show like this when you ask me, and to talk about what I know.
I've quoted both Ibram X. Kendi and Bryan Stevenson a lot in this program. Mm-hmm. And both of them say that there's a lot of denial of history. Ibram Kendi even says, and I quote, that denial is the heart of racism, unquote. What do you think about denial that we see today?
Well, again, I think to your earlier question, that's really baked in. That it's easier for people in their daily life, I think, to sort of push away that bigger history that we're all inside of, and to really sort of see it as that has nothing to do with me. And what you do when you do that is you actually deny history. We're all a product of, we're all functions of our history. And so as a very sort of personal example, I talked with my students about to understand what's my connection to this history and to the history of segregation. At the end of the Second World War, the GI Bill gets passed, which is a really important piece of legislation to help returning veterans from the war. Millions of African Americans serve in the Second World War. They're supposed to share in the benefits the same way as any other veteran coming back. The two big benefits are housing mortgages guaranteed by banks so people can sort of reach the American so-called dream of being a homeowner. And the second one is being able to go to college. Your college tuition could be paid for through the GI Bill. But if you're African American and you're in the South, and there are very few, if any, colleges and universities like in Alabama or Mississippi or Louisiana or wherever, they're going to take a black student, what do you do with the GI Bill for education? And even in the North, which is highly segregated in terms of housing, where are you going to buy a home? And so the GI Bill is seen by lots of people as the stepping stone for lots of working class people like my dad, who was a meat cutter, to aspire in a way to being in the middle class. And the history of racism and segregation in the country denied a gigantic portion of the American population the ability to take advantage of those fruits. That's wrong, and we are all, whether we like it or not, we're products of that. That's just the reality. You can say you're not, but if you're living in America in 2020, you're at least in part a product of that segregation. And there's no other way to get around it. It is what it is.
Thank you very much. And thank you to all of you for watching.
Oh, that actually worked out better.
Yeah, well, when I in the morning, baby, when I rise, baby, you have a thought I have a moon, well, in my right side, well,